This is The Bible Line, a live radio call-in program with Dr. Carl Brogy. Dr. Brogy is the senior pastor of Community Bible Church of Beaufort, South Carolina. And for the next hour, he's available to answer your questions, providing biblical insight and wisdom for everyday Christian living. Our phone lines are open, and if you have a question, you may call 525-1859 locally or outside the immediate area. Call toll-free 877-924-7980. Now let's join Dr. Carl Brogy.
Be diligent to present yourself approved to God as a workman who does not need to be ashamed, accurately handling the word of truth. We welcome you this hour to the Bible Line. If you are a first-time listener at WAGP.net through our app that you can download at the App Store into your phone, or you're listening at 88.7 FM, we welcome you. For the next hour, we will be taking people's questions. Maybe it's a particular issue in your life or ministry or family, and you're looking for biblical counsel, or some theological issue you're trying to understand and wrestle with. If we can be of help, by God's grace, we will. The toll-free 877 number is simply the call letters WAGP980. Or you can reach us at the South Carolina 843 Exchange. And that 843 Exchange number is simply 525-1859. When you call, we do give preference to live callers or those who dictate. We're happy to receive them that way. You can also always reach us at the Bible Line, tbl@wagp.net. So with that said, Walter, let's go ahead and we'll get started this morning.
All right. Good morning, Pastor Carl. Our first question comes from Kimberly out of Beaufort, South Carolina, and she writes, "As I read books and listen to sermons on heaven, pastors and authors, perhaps due to their difference in eschatology, don't seem to carefully differentiate between pre-resurrection temporal state and the place of departed believers and the resurrected state after the rapture. Their timeline of events seem to be inaccurate. As someone who is searching the scriptures, desiring the comfort of understanding what joy my loved one is experiencing now as he waits in his glorified body, I find this disheartening. Will you please bring clarity to this subject with the solid teaching of the word, providing as much detail as God has revealed about the pre-resurrection state of the believer who is, and I quote, absent from the body, present with the Lord, end quote. I am sure countless and others would appreciate it so much. Thank you very much."
Well, Kim, I'm sorry for your loss. It's grievous when you lose someone that you've been married to for a long time. And the passage that I would direct you to in messages that I have at searchthescriptures.org dealing with death and the state of a loved one, I would especially highlight 1 Thessalonians 4:13-18. Number one, because Paul concludes that paragraph by saying, "Therefore, comfort one another with these words." I suppose there is a lack of teaching in this area, but there's just a lack of teaching on eschatology. Eschatos, that's a new word to some people. You used it, but it refers to last things. And so eschatology is the study of last things. And so when we think of the prophetic nature of Scripture, about a third of the Bible is prophetic in nature. And much of it is yet to be fulfilled, and it is built around the second coming of Christ. And the second coming program is around two particular events. One is called the rapture, and the other is the return of Christ to the earth. In the rapture, we meet him in the air. At the second coming, he comes to the earth. But he says here, "We'll not have you to be uninformed." It's the Greek word agnosis. Gnosis is our word for knowledge, and so you alpha prefix it. It means someone who doesn't know. Know nothing, you might say. We get our word agnostic from it. And sadly, there are a lot of people who are uninformed. The Old English renders it ignorant. In fact, he uses this word in reference to those who are ignorant about spiritual gifts in 1 Corinthians 12, those who are ignorant about the state and role in future for the people of Israel. And there's gross ignorance in both these areas. And certainly those who are ignorant in terms of processing in their mind trials that we face in life. And so here he's speaking about ignorance about those who are asleep. Asleep is a euphemism for death. A euphemism is a nice way of saying something. And those who have died, those who have fallen asleep, and really it's a beautiful picture, because just as last night you laid down in a bed and got up this morning, those who've been laid down in a grave, someday their body will get up. And so he says, I'm writing to you so you're not ignorant or uninformed about those who have died, so that you not grieve like the rest who have no hope. So we grieve, you're grieving, but we don't have to grieve, obviously, like those who have no hope. Why? Because if we believe Jesus died and rose again, and we believe that, that's our confession, that's what your husband believed, even so God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep. Underscore in your mind, with him. Why? Because as you noted, absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. For me to live is Christ, to die is gain. And so when the body is described as sleep, the soul, the person inside the body, is not asleep. We call a cemetery. It comes from a Latin word, cemeterion, and it means a sleeping place. And it's in reference to the body. And so the moment your husband died, the person inside went home to be with the Lord. Now, what was his state? Is he in some disembodied state? No, clearly from the revelation, we learn this through tribulation saints who have died, who have yet to see their resurrection because they're part of the first resurrection program at the second coming, yet they're dressed in some kind of robe. So we're not disembodied spirits, but neither are we in our resurrected body. We are awaiting that. And he tells us that in the text, because if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, he's going to bring with him those who've died or fallen asleep in Jesus. So he's bringing back from heaven those who are in Jesus, because those are the only folks in heaven. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will not precede those who have fallen asleep. And so their concern was not with the doctrine of the resurrection. Moses taught it. Job taught it. It's found in the Old Testament prophets. What they didn't understand concerned the timing of the resurrection. What if someone had already died before Christ comes to catch up the church? And so he says, the Lord will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them. And so the first to go up with Jesus are those who have already died. So he brings their spirit back from heaven, reconnects it with that body, wherever it is, whatever it's turned into, if it even physically could be identified by a human, God will find it. But that body is not suited for heaven. This mortal must put on immortality. This perishable must put on the imperishable. And so in the twinkling of an eye, that body will be changed, and God will reconnect the spirit in heaven with that resurrection body. They go up first. We who are alive and remain will meet them in the air. So there's going to be a reunion in the skies. There's an assumption that, yes, you will recognize your loved ones. What age will they be if an infant died or if someone died at 100? We don't know. Maybe we'll all be like 30. Who knows? We're not told. But we will be recognizable and will be in a body that will live forever, pain-free, trouble-free, a body suited for heaven. This is the doctrine of the catching up. In Latin, it's the word raptoro, and we get our English word rapture. It's harpazo. In Greek, it means to be caught up. All Christians believe in the catching up. Now, some debate in terms of the timing, but all believe in the catching up of bodies out of the grave to be reunited with the Spirit to be ready for heaven. And so there's great comfort in that. Your husband is more alive than he's ever been. Now, that's a short answer. You came to Community Bible Church years ago. I know you moved to another community. It's not that far. You might consider coming back if you're not learning prophetic portions of Scripture. Any pastor who teaches books of the Bible is going to address the prophetic issues because, again, about a third of the Bible is prophetic. You're going to habitually bump into these passages, and you have to address them. You can't skip them. And there's much to be learned and much to be applied in the prophetic portions of Scripture. But for now, go to searchthescriptures.org, type in 1 Thessalonians 4, or you could type in God's prophetic series, and you'd find the latest message I have on 1 Thessalonians 4, and I think that would be really helpful to you. Good question, Kimberly. Let us know if we can help you with anything else. Let's go to the next question, Walter.
All right, Pastor Carl, 843-525-1859 if you have a question for Pastor Carl on this morning's Bible Line. Our next question comes from John out of Garnet, South Carolina, and he writes, my faith and relationship with Christ is very strong. I have been through a lot in the last 2 years in losing my wife to cancer, family division, plus more. I've stayed close to God through it all. I moved to a hunt camp in South Carolina from Florida. I feel God is leading me into ministry. I've stepped up my studies. I've created a prayer ministry, became a deacon at my church, and then chair deacon. My comprehension abilities in Scripture has increased. So is it wrong I feel God is leading me into ministry because I don't feel like it is me doing so?
Well, it's a good question, and it's a question that more men need to ask, and women who might be called to be missionaries and serve in some other capacity than a pastor. But with that said, in the most basic sense, I would just remind you that we're all called to ministry in the sense that we have been entrusted to the Great Commission, John. And so sometimes if a person starts growing in their faith, and sometimes God uses hard times, uses trials, and I know you've been through a lot here as you give us some bio on what's happened in the last few years, but by God's grace, you've responded well, and instead of these difficulties repelling you away from the Lord, they're drawing you closer to the Lord. And so you might just be growing more and have a sense that I want to serve the Lord. That's not necessarily a call to ministry. In fact, on your spiritual birthday, God gave you a spiritual gift. Peter will say in 1 Peter 4:10, as each one has received a special gift, employ it in serving one another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. So you want to find out what your spiritual gift is and utilize it in the local assembly. You're already serving in some capacity. We can all be salt and light in the church, outside of the church. Vocational ministry, which is what I'm assuming you are referring to, it certainly has some unique demands, and you want to make sure that this is a call from God and not just something that you've dreamed up. Some people assume that because you're growing and excited and want to serve the Lord, that that means a call to ministry because they had never sensed that before. Well, that may not be a call to ministry. That just may be that you found a good church where you're growing and you want to plug in and use your spiritual gift or gifts for the ministry. Sometimes people, quote, feel a call to the ministry because they are living up to someone else's expectations. Their dad was a preacher. Their grandfather was a preacher. Maybe they even thought as a young man, I'll be a preacher. And they stated that and said that in their naivete when they didn't really have the spiritual growth and maturity to discern if that was a call from God. And now people expect it of them. You can't live up to people's expectations, of course. You want to do what God wants you to do. Some I've seen wrestle with the ministry out of a sense of guilt, and that's certainly not a reason. So as a starting place, there's a verse that I love. It's found in Psalm 37. I'm just flipping over there right now, Psalm 37. And he makes this statement, delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord. Trust also in him, and he will do it. And he'll bring forth your righteousness as the light and your judgment as the new day sun. Rest in the Lord and wait patiently for him. So delight yourself in the Lord. He needs to be the central focus of your heart. And when it says he'll give you the desires of the heart, what that means in the Hebrew text, it carries the idea those desires you have in your heart will originate from God. So as you're seeking to please the Lord, he burdens you with a new passion, maybe to share your faith or to serve in some ministry in the local church. And that may grow and deepen and broaden even into some kind of vocational Christian ministry. So I would say this, if it's vocational Christian ministry, you have to ask, well, what kind of vocational Christian ministry? You know, we have a missionary our church supports. We have hundreds of missionaries we support, but I'm thinking of a guy named Daryl, and Daryl serves with a ministry that basically in the Philippines that ministers to people's needs, missionaries' needs, like the window breaks in their house, their car has broken, and what does he do? He's Mr. Fix-It Man. That's what he's good at. He has mechanical skills, and he has the gift of serving. Now, if you asked him to preach a sermon, I suppose he would if you were in a jam, but his giftedness is not in that area. So there's vocational Christian ministry where you can serve in a plethora of avenues in ways. We need more than ever missionaries who will not just plant trees and dig wells, though that may give a platform for some. But we need more than anything those who will get into the trenches, share the gospel, plant local churches, establish churches. And that's really the model that's emphasized and underscored in the Acts of the Apostles. So you need to ask, well, vocational Christian ministry, if it's the pastorate, am I gifted to be a pastor? And so there are men who are in the pastorate who shouldn't be in the pastorate. They may have the gift of administration. They could be maybe a pastor, but not the teaching pastor. So there's different kinds of shepherds in the church, different kind of elders. And so Paul underscores those who work hard at preaching and teaching. So we have elders on our church staff, on our church board, on the board of Community Bible Church, who are gifted men, but not all as preachers. And that's okay. That doesn't disqualify them from being an elder. So there's the elder and then those who work hard at preaching and teaching. That's called the pastor teacher, the teaching elder. And if God's gifted you in that way, and that's actually a singular gift in Ephesians 4 when he speaks of the evangelists and pastors and teachers, pastor/teacher, it's connected in the Greek. It's a singular gift, a singular calling. And so ideally, if someone serves in the office of pastor as what we might call the senior pastor of a church, to use 21st century vocabulary, he has the gift of a pastor teacher. So if you don't have that gift and you're seeking to serve as the lead man in the local assembly, you're headed in the wrong direction. How do you know if you have that gift? Well, number one, there is a sense of blessing when you teach the Word of God. People are responsive. If you have the gift of teaching or the gift of pastor teacher, folks within your congregation will have the gift of listening. And there are some people, if you want to go to sleep, listen to their sermon, and it'll be like an anesthetic at night if you can't sleep well. So you want to make sure that, again, there's a sense of call and a sense of affirmation from wise men. Proverbs 11:14, I think the other is 15:22, talks about there's wisdom in seeking a multiplicity of counselors. So understand that the call to vocational ministry is not easy. It's difficult. Many pastors quit. Why? Because they're criticized. They are unappreciated often. They get hate mail. They are told everything they're doing wrong. And some are getting negative feedback because they shouldn't be in the ministry to begin with. So God's called you to serve. He's called every believer to serve. Maybe he's called you to vocational Christian ministry. If he has, you need to ask, has he called me to be a pastor? James warns, let not many of you become teachers, knowing that you incur stricter judgment, so you don't hustle into this position. And two, you need to make sure, based on 1 Timothy 3, Titus 1, that you have the qualifications for an elder, because if you don't, then you shouldn't pursue that office. All right, good question. Let's go on to the next.
All right, Pastor Carl. Our next question comes from Judith out of Okotee, South Carolina, and she writes, I caught an earlier broadcast while driving in the car in which you referred to the festivals of Israel and said that there were six, but Leviticus 23 clearly details seven annual festivals, the Sabbath being an additional weekly observance. Which two did you combine? My guess is Passover and unleavened bread. Did you do that to make John's gospel more closely follow the timeline of the synoptics?
Well, I don't know what sermon you were listening to, but when you speak to Orthodox Jews, they'll say there's either six or seven feasts. It just depends how you count them. Passover is celebrated on the 14th day of Nisan, and the Jewish calendar, of course, is indexed to both the moon and the sun. And that's why Easter doesn't always fall on the same date every year. Ideally, if we followed the Jewish calendar, we would have Good Friday, so to speak, on Jewish Passover. But with that said, it's on the 14th day of Nisan. Unleavened bread, that starts in the 15th day of Nisan, and it lasts for 7 days, and it overlaps with Passover. And of course, you know, it involves eating unleavened bread to remember their escape from Egypt. But those two festivals are linked in the mind of an Orthodox Jew, and they are observed consecutively, and so they're often seen as one. So sometimes a pastor will describe six festivals, technically seven, Passover, unleavened bread. So, of course, in the year Jesus died, Passover on that year, happened to fall on Friday, unleavened bread on Saturday, and the Feast of First Fruits on Sunday. And so the Feast of First Fruits was the day he was raised from the dead. So he dies on Passover. His sinless body is in the tomb on unleavened bread, and it's raised on the Feast of First Fruits in keeping with that. And then, of course, 50 days later, on Shavuot, the 50th day of the Feast of Weeks, Pentecost occurs. So Shavuot or Pentecost or the Feast of Weeks, depending what term you want to use, that's the day the church was born. And I think that's significant. That, too, is a Sunday. We worship on the first day of the week, not because God has changed, but we're in a different economy. And in this economy, the Lord of the Sabbath dictated that we meet on the first day of the week. So the church, unless they're going into a synagogue to reach Jews, because you went to the Jew first and then to the Greek, they met on the first day of the week. The Lord of the Sabbath was raised on the first day of the week. He started his church on the first day of the week. All of the appearings in the Gospels took place on the first day of the week. So those four different celebrations, festivals, were all fulfilled in the first coming of Christ. We still have the Feast of Trumpets. Sometimes it's referred to as Rosh Hashanah, the Day of Atonement, Yom Kippur, Yom meaning day, Kippur, Atonement, and the Feast of Tabernacles, which the Jews, again, they recognize all of these. They celebrate them. They literally get in little tabernacles. It's really pretty cool how they do it, how they turn their back porches into a tabernacle, or they build them outside their home, depending what city they are in and where they're located. And again, that lasts for 7 days. But each of these pictured either something that's already been fulfilled or something that will be fulfilled. And the final three will be fulfilled starting in the Great Tribulation period and culminating with the Messiah, when tabernacles, which of course celebrated the Israelis living for 40 years in the desert in temporary shelters, but it will on that day celebrate a permanent shelter when Messiah comes to rule and reign. Anyway, I could go on and just say, some people will say, well, there's eight feasts, and they'll add, you know, they'll take the six where they combine the two, or they'll say there's nine feasts. And of course, there's a Feast of Purim, but that's not dictated as such by Moses, but it's mentioned, of course, in the book of Esther. And then there's a feast that is established when the temple is retaken over, and we call that Hanukkah, or the Feast of Lights. And Jesus even himself in John's Gospel recognized Hanukkah. So we might even say there's nine feasts. But in either case, just depends how you catch me on a given day, whether I'm thinking with my Jewish friends, my Orthodox friends, or I'm thinking otherwise. Good question, though. I'm glad you're listening. Let's go to the next one.
All right, Pastor Carl. Our next question comes from Grace out of Pantops, Virginia, and she writes, following October 7th, 2023, I have continued to hear more people say that the church has replaced Israel and that God is done with Israel. I firmly believe this isn't true and have listened to your sermons on Romans 9 through 11 addressing this. But I recently saw a person post on social media that the church has replaced Israel, and his proof text was Galatians chapter 6, verse 16, referencing the Israel of God. He was claiming that Paul was writing to a Christian church and calling them the new Israel, based on the very clear scripture saying that God's covenant with Israel is forever and no disobedience or hard-heartedness can change that. I can't accept his interpretation of this verse from Galatians. It seems so contradictory to everything in Scripture, but how would you respond to this assertion that Galatians 6:16 is proof that the church is the new Israel, and how can I directly show that the verse is not saying that? Thank you for your ministry.
Well, remember, the best interpreter of Scripture is Scripture itself. So what you're dealing with is replacement theology. Those Christians, and there's some, you know, fine Christian people who love Christ. They have the gospel. I'm grateful for them, but they're very misinformed. They come out of the theology and perspective of Calvin, who comes out of Catholicism, and they're largely built and driven by St. Augustine, who writes the first book on the kingdom of God, saying that the church had replaced Israel. And Augustine, you know, he had some confessing to do, or he had his evaluation in heaven. I'm not saying he's not a Christian, but he said some awful things about the Jewish people, just like John Calvin did, just like Martin Luther did. But again, Genesis 15, 8 through 21, I would start you there. It's the Abrahamic covenant. God makes a covenant with Israel, with Abraham, who's the founder of the nation. And it's a unilateral covenant. And in those days, when you wanted to cut a covenant, that was the most serious covenant you could make. You would cut animals in two, and then each person would walk between the animals, and you were basically saying, if I don't do like I've promised on this day, you can do to me what I've done to these animals. When we were kids, we used to make ourselves a blood brothers, and you'd cut your finger and you'd make a promise. And, you know, I don't know if we got that from the Indians or on all the Westerns we watched, but it's similar. It's a serious commitment. It's stronger than a handshake. Let's just put it that way. But when God takes Abraham, he puts Abraham to sleep, and God alone walks through the pieces, because the fulfillment of the covenant is not based on Abraham's obedience. It's based on God himself. The fact that God has not replaced Israel, and I'm again heading towards your passage, I'm turning now to Matthew 23. Jesus has entered Jerusalem. It's the final week, Palm Sunday, and he's brokenhearted. He said, how often I wanted to gather your children together the way a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, and you are unwilling. And so here's Jesus lamenting over Jerusalem. It's Matthew 23. And then he says, behold, your house is being left to you desolate. The house here, contextually, is used throughout the Bible, is in reference to the temple. The temple is going to be left desolate. It was one of the seven wonders of the world in the first century. It was just breathtaking. It was magnificent. And then Jesus said, for I say to you, from now on, you will not see me until you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. That's Psalm 118, 26. It's a messianic psalm. And the Jewish people to whom he is speaking, he's saying, you're not going to see me again. I will not return until the nation of Israel is converted. So to say that God is done with the Jew is just foolish. You have to spiritualize passages like this. And then, of course, he goes on in the Olivet Discourse, and that's what these people do. The amillennialist, who is misrepresenting Galatians 6:16, probably takes a preterist view of Matthew 24. They say, oh, yeah, all this was fulfilled in the first century. You know, the earthquakes, and they had some famines back then. And, yeah, this is all first century stuff. Well, I don't think so. In fact, Jesus makes a statement in verse 22 of Matthew 24. Unless those days had been cut short, no life would have been saved. So he's describing a time that is unparalleled in human history. Read the Revelation for details. So when you put together the Abrahamic covenant, you put passages together like Matthew 23, we could have looked at Matthew 25, where there's a coming judgment, verses 31 through 46, on how people treat Israel. This judgment happens on the earth when the Messiah returns, and there's two groups of people. There's three, actually. There's goats, there's sheep, and there's my brethren. And these are Gentiles. It's the judgment of the ethnoi, the nations, and they are separated as believers or unbelievers based on the way they dealt with the Jews who are converted during the tribulation, because they will be the most hated people on the planet. And Zechariah 12 speaks about all the nations of the world going against them, but they're also going to be converted. A third of the Jewish people will survive, and the vast majority will be converted. They'll look on him whom they have pierced. They'll mourn for him as one mourns for an only son. In Acts 1, at the ascension, these men, these apostles, knew that God was not done with Israel. So when they had come together, they were asking him, saying, Lord, is it at this time you're restoring the kingdom to Israel? Now, if God were done with Israel, this would have been a perfect time to say, oh, no, no, you know, the church is the new Israel. Forget that. No, he doesn't discount it. He just says it's not for you to know the times or the epochs. It's going to happen. You just don't need to know when. And so he doesn't discount his role with Israel. You could affirm the same thing in Romans 11. And in Romans, the 11th chapter, and I'm glad you listened to 9, 10, and 11, because the way I'm assuming the guy who is, you know, interpreting Galatians 6:16 the way he is, that individual as such is an amillennialist, and his interpretation of Romans 9, 10, and 11 is driven because he's looking through the lens that God is finished with Israel, and God is not finished with Israel. God is committed to the people of Israel. He has a plan for Israel. I say then, they did not stumble so as to fall, did they? May it never be. By their transgressions, salvation has come to the Gentiles to make them jealous. Now, if their transgression is riches for the world and their failure is riches for the Gentiles, how much more will their fulfillment be? So he's looking to this future time when God is going to work in the hearts of the Jewish people. And God right now is largely working through a Gentile church, though Paul affirms that God is not done with the Jewish people. He still has a plan for them. And so the chapter opens, Romans 11. I say then, God has not rejected his people. Has he? May it never be. No, God hasn't rejected the people of Israel. He's going to culminate human history through Israel. And this is why so many Christians are asleep today. They have no idea of what's happening. The fact that we're in the final time frame of human history. And we know that because in the final time frame of human history, God would reestablish the Jewish people in the land and gather them from the four corners of the world. And it's happened in my lifetime. They are a nation. Since May 14th, 1948, there was only 600,000 Jews in Israel at that time. Now there's over 7 million. There's more Jews living on the land of Israel than all the nations combined. And they're there from over 100 countries. This is what God said would happen at the end. Add to that the moral climate, the days of Noah, the days of Lot, days of moral impropriety, days of moral perversion, days of lawlessness, days of violence. Add to that days of apostasy. We know we're in the final time frame. No one knows the day or the hour, but people are asleep. There's this small segment of land that's no bigger than Delaware, a group of people that are minuscule compared to the 8.3 billion people on the planet, and yet they have the world's attention. Because God's not done with Israel. So I've turned to Galatians 6:16. And those who will walk by this rule, peace and mercy be upon them and upon the Israel of God. So some would say the Israel of God is the church, the body of Christ. Jewish believers and Gentiles believers, but that's not what he is speaking about here. First, there's a repetition of the word to or upon. And he says it twice. He says, and those who will walk by this rule, peace and mercy be upon them. And then there's a second upon, and upon a second group, the Israel of God. And when you look into the New Testament, 65 other occurrences where you find the word Israel. And in every single occurrence, and no one would debate, it's always referring to literal, physical Jewish people, descendants of Abraham, and not Gentile Christians. And so to make this refer differently really is a poor exegetical conclusion. And so I will say this, though. I should say it because the New International Version, which became a very popular version in the 1980s when it came out, they render this verse a little bit differently. They say, peace and mercy to all who follow this rule, even to the Israel of God. And that's not what the New Testament reads. And so that could lead someone to think, well, this is in reference to the body of Christ, even to the Israel of God. But actually, there's a chi there. It means and. Chi epiton Israel tu theou, and upon the Israel of God. It's specifically segmented. But you see, the NIV is somewhat of a paraphrased translation, but it became very popular in the 80s because people were looking for something other than the King James Version. The New American Standard had come out, but it was still somewhat wooden, but it was very literal. And so your Bible teachers were all using the NASB. But those who didn't really exposit the scripture, and there's not much expository preaching going on in the evangelical American church, they went to the NIV. But I will say, apart from that, every English translation, ESV, Net Bible, CJB, CSB, HCSB, New King James, Old King James, they all render it and upon the Israel of God. So they are clearly delineating a separate group of people. But again, you know, if all I had was Galatians 6:16, I might fall into that error, though it would be difficult to do so. But since I have the Old Testament and all the promises of Scripture concerning the Jews and a fulfillment of prophecy concerning the Jews for the return of Jesus, then I know it cannot possibly mean that. But if you start with the premise God's done with the Jew, you have to spiritualize hundreds and hundreds of passages of Scripture. So when God talks about the Messiah putting his feet on the Mount of Olives and splitting it in two, did he mean that? Yeah, he meant it. In fact, in Acts 1, when he's ascending, the angel said he's going to return in the exact same way he left. He left the Mount of Olives. He's coming back to the Mount of Olives. All the prophecies in Zechariah for the first coming were literally fulfilled. Why should we spiritualize the prophecies for the second coming? We shouldn't. And so when he steps on the Mount of Olives and he splits it in two, and there's a river that will flow from the Temple Mount all the way to the Dead Sea, and the Dead Sea will be made alive, did he mean that in Ezekiel 47? Oh, people say, who are amillennialists who abuse Galatians 6:16, oh, that's just a picture of regeneration, of someone being born again. And so what do you have? You have six interpretations on how you interpret Ezekiel 37. Why? Because if you spiritualize it, you have to come up with your definition of what's right. But if you apply a historical, grammatical, literal interpretation that's consistent, and there's the problem, because some of my amillennial brothers, they apply a literal, historical, grammatical interpretation, except on passages that deal with the future of Israel, and there they spiritualize it. And so they're not consistent. Anyway, good question. We could spend a lot more time on it, but I might direct you to my series called God's Prophetic Schedule, where I address a lot of these issues. Listen to all 32 messages, and you'll really be grounded in this truth.
All right, Pastor Carl, our next question comes from Sarah out of Orlando, Florida, and she writes, I am a young wife with a two-year-old. When my husband and I were first dating, we attended the same church and worked for the same ministry. Since being married, my husband's attitude towards marriage and family has been disappointing. He recently has become obsessed with the Catholic Church and is attempting to force conversion on me, or he will divorce me, saying our marriage isn't valid because it was not inside the Catholic Church. Much of our conversation centered around the debate on the Catholic Church. What do you recommend me to do in terms of submission? I have received Christ as my Lord. I just do not believe in the teaching and practices of the Catholic Church, and I am losing hope. Please help me with what you think I should do.
Well, it's a fair question, and my heart breaks for you, because sometimes the enemies of our own household oppose us because we are followers of Christ. Now, your husband, if he's obsessed with Catholicism, and he went to any priest, the priest would say, well, look, you're not supposed to divorce your wife for this. So he's not even following Catholic doctrine on this. But with that said, you want to pray for him, maybe even fast for him. And so there are times maybe when you would skip a meal and go into the prayer closet and get on your knees and say, Lord, you need to work. And very often, you know, when you have skipped a meal and you are fasting, Psalm 35, verse 13 reminds us that that hunger pain becomes an impetus to carry a prayer to the Lord. And so when you feel that hunger, just use it to pour your heart out before the Lord for this need that you have. But God is going to have to break through. And so he says, I humbled my soul with fasting, and my prayer kept returning to my bosom. That's what fasting does. And you plead with the Lord. Now, part of it may, too, be educational. One, you want to make sure that you really know what Roman Catholics teach. Now, myself, I'm a converted Roman Catholic, and I'm not one of, I was not one of these, you know, twice a year Roman Catholics or a light Roman Catholic, Catholicism light, as we called it. No, I was deeply entrenched. I was, you know, First Communion, Confirmation. I was an altar boy for 7 years, the whole nine yards. Catechism from kindergarten all the way through my senior year in high school. Then I studied under the Jesuits. The Jesuits was a teaching order established by the Pope to basically officially represent the church on issues of doctrine. And so actually the largest community of Jesuits in the world were professors at Boston College, where I did my undergraduate work. So while the university was not taught every class by a Jesuit, every department was led by a Jesuit, and they had certain standards. And, of course, sadly, many of the Jesuits there were hypocrites. They said one thing and lived an entirely different lifestyle. But with that said, you want to know what the church actually teaches. And so a couple of books that I would recommend, one is by Lorraine Bettner. It's simply called Roman Catholicism. It came out in 1962. I still have my original copy. The date on it is 1976. And it's been in continuous print since 1962. Look for a book to be in continuous print. It's got some substance to it. And so it's really a superb work. It's very, very well done. And I would point you to that book. The other resource that I think is absolutely excellent, it's called Preparing Catholics for Eternity. In fact, it's in Spanish and in English. It's by Mike Gendron, G-E-N-D-R-O-N. In fact, if you wanted a lot of resources on really being boned up on what Catholics teach, because very often, you know, I hear evangelicals create these straw men and they tear them down. And that does a disservice to trying to reach a Roman Catholic for Christ. And so when I was a kid, they say, oh, you're a Catholic. You can sin all you want all week long, and you just go to confession on Saturday. Well, that was a straw man. That's not true, and I didn't believe that, and I knew the church didn't teach that. So you want to make sure that you're knocking down an iron man and not a straw man. And his book, Preparing Roman Catholics for Eternity, will not only help you in terms of what do they actually teach, but it will also help you to evangelize. And so being educated, I think, would be very helpful. So you could get your husband, you take it just little baby pieces at a time. And you could use Mike Gendron's book or Lorraine Bettner's book. And Gendron's is very user-friendly, so I would point you there. Bettner's book is, I don't want to say that Mike's is unscholarly, because it certainly is not. But it's a little less user-friendly and a little more cumbersome. That might be a better way to put it. So I'd recommend Gendron's book. In fact, Mike Gendron will be at Community Bible Church September 13th, 14th, and 15th for a weekend conference. You could drive up with your husband. Maybe you could make a deal with him and say, well, look, I want to really know if what I am rejecting is false. And there's this man who was raised Catholic, deeply entrenched until his 30s, and he says that the Catholic Church is not teaching what the Bible says. And if you can show me where he is in error, then I'll convert. Now, he won't be able to do that, but you could put that out there as a challenge to him. Let's go out for a weekend. If you have children, get a babysitter and come for the weekend. Or you could live stream it. It will be live streamed across the nation. So you could live stream it on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday as well. Though it would be far better to come and physically be present. That way, if your husband has questions or challenges, he can address them directly to our speaker that weekend. So Mike's a great brother. He went to Dallas Theological Seminary, as did I, and he's preached in our church before. But this weekend conference, I would say to anyone listening, if you really want to understand what Roman Catholicism is about and how to effectively win to Christ your Roman Catholic friends, you may be thinking, well, they're just Christians, just of a different stripe. No, they're not. They have a different gospel. They do not teach salvation by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone, based on the Bible alone. They preach a different Jesus. That's not to say that every Roman Catholic is lost. There are some who independently of the church have found Christ. But what typically happens is they start growing as they leave the church. Many have come to faith over the years through this radio station listening to me teach. And then they end up coming to Community Bible Church because the more they heard God's word, they saw the inconsistency between what they were learning at the Roman church and what the scripture actually says. So ultimately, in the end, it comes down to an issue of authority. And they'll try to convince you that, well, you can't read the Bible for yourself. Look, you're a thinking person. God admonishes us to read the scriptures, to search the scriptures. We should be like the Bereans. And so you can read and understand the scriptures. It's not to say that there aren't sections that are difficult and challenging, but you need to read the scriptures for your own. So that's what I would say. Don't get a divorce. If he divorces you, don't let it be on you. You don't agree to anything. You say, no, I'm committed to this marriage, and you should be too, because your church teaches that you should be committed to. So you're actually going against the Roman church. And you could actually get some chapter and verses out of their own documents to share that with him. But for him to dump you over this, oh, that's a tragedy of tragedies. Anyway, good question. Let's go to the next.
All right, Pastor Carl. Our next question comes from Anne Marie out of Richmond, Rhode Island, and she writes, "Hello, Dr. Brogy. First, I would like to thank you for your ministry, and I am very grateful to get to listen and learn from you. I am also grateful to my friend that introduced me. I heard you say in a sermon that there are 17 Old Testament prophets, so that is Samuel, the 12 minor, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and Daniel. Is that correct? And thank you."
No, it's a good question. So, you're not exactly on target. So I'm not sure what you heard me say, but we speak of major prophets and minor prophets. So there are five books done by four prophets that we call the major prophets. And that would be like Isaiah, Jeremiah, Lamentations. Lamentations was written by Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and Daniel. So those five books represent the major prophets. And they're referred to as major prophets first and foremost because of the length of the books. They're much longer than what we call the minor prophets. The term major and minor prophets was a 4th century AD designation that was given to these 17 books. So then there's 12 minor prophets because they're shorter, and the scope tends to be more specific. With the major prophets, many of them have global implications. Where the minor prophets, again, they're described as minor because they're shorter, though Hosea and Zechariah are almost as long as Daniel, but the content tends to be more narrowly focused. But they're not any less inspired, so maybe that's a deficit in the term. People think, well, the major prophets, those five are more important than the minor prophets. They're not. They're all important. It's all God-breathed. And so when you think of the minor prophets, there's Hosea, Joel, Amos, Obadiah, Jonah, Micah, Nahum, Habakkuk, Zephaniah, Haggai, Zechariah, Malachi. I would have my kids cite those, Jonah, Micah, Nahum, and say that real fast. And then we go HZHZM. HZHZM, Habakkuk, Zephaniah, Haggai, Zechariah, Malachi. Those 12 are the minor prophets, and they're together in your English Bible. They're divided up a little bit differently in the Jewish Bible, but in our English Bible, they're all found together. Now, beyond that, there are prophets of God that do not have a book, say, titled by them. Isaiah is written by Isaiah. Lamentations, well, it's written by Jeremiah. Jeremiah is written by Jeremiah. Obadiah is written by Obadiah. Micah is written by Micah. Malachi by Malachi, and so forth. But there are other prophets in the Bible. Maybe more notable, you'll remember Elijah and Elisha. Elijah is a major prophet of the Old Testament, and he had that confrontation, if you remember, with the prophets of Baal up there on top of Mount Carmel. You can read of his life in 1 and 2 Kings. And then you have Elisha. He becomes the successor. I always remember J comes before S. as a new Christian. So Elijah comes before Elisha, and Elisha performed much of the miracles that Elijah did, and the baton was passed to him, and you read him about in 2 Kings. But you can read about other prophets, too, like Nathan. Remember Nathan the prophet? He's the one who confronts David, or the prophet Gad, who served during the reign of David, and so on. And so there's a number of other prophets, Abijah, Jehu, and Samuel the prophet. But he's not considered one of the major or minor prophets. So when we think of the major and minor prophets, we're speaking at a different time in Israel's history. So when you think of Israel, you can think of them, they were either a united kingdom with 12 tribes, and so you have some prophets that preach to the united kingdom. And then if you remember, because of Solomon's compromise, the kingdom was torn in two. God, because of David, waited until after Solomon died, and Solomon's son Jeroboam steps on the throne, listens to the younger leadership who were inexperienced. He wants to treat the people with a sense of harshness, and 10 of the northern tribes said, we're out of here. And so when you think of the major and minor, those 17, you want to ask, when are they preaching? Are they preaching before the exile? Are they preaching to the northern kingdom, the southern kingdom? Are they preaching after or during the exile? And there's just two that preach during that time. That's Ezekiel and Daniel. Or are they preaching after the exile, after they return back to the land? And when you understand the historical context, they come alive for you. It's a great question. I appreciate it so much. Let's go on to the next.
All right, Pastor, I believe we have time for one more. It comes from Stephen out of Seabrook, South Carolina, and he writes, can you please explain this verse to me, Proverbs chapter 6, verse 16? There are six things that the Lord hates, yes, seven, which are an abomination to him.
Well, it's a good question. I'm assuming you're keying off of there's six, yea, seven. And that is a rhetorical device of sorts that are used in the poetry, Hebrew poetry. It's a literary device where you have six things and you add a seventh. And the seventh is usually added to underscore the importance of the whole group, but usually with emphasis on the final one. So there are three things, yea, four, and with emphasis on the fourth. So they're pretty obvious, which I think, you know, haughty eyes or pride or lying tongue, dishonesty or hands that shed innocent blood. My, we're seeing that this week, aren't we? As or in this past week, where people at the Democrat National Convention, they are setting up abortion clinics for free abortions. That's murder, shedding innocent blood, a heart that devises wicked schemes. You know, people who plan evil. Feet that run to evil, a false witness, God hates that, bearing false witness against your neighbor, and a person who stirs up, you know, conflict, they create discord. And in that one, God really hates, among others. And so he's just using a literary device to, one, help someone to memorize something. And so when you had these groupings, people would often memorize the grouping, but the addition in the grouping was a way in which you underscored the final in the group for further reflection. God hates those who create discord in the fellowship because it's just so very, very damaging. Well, anyway, we're out of time, but I hope that was helpful to you today. We'll be back, Lord willing, next Tuesday for the Bible Line. And in the interim, I would say to you that if you have questions, you can write us at TBL at the Bible Line at WAGP.net, or you can call the 843-525-1859 number, and there's a prompt in which you can leave a 60-second or less question, assuming you don't mind our using your voice on the air. So keep that in mind, and if you don't have a church home, I want to invite you to Community Bible Church. We're a non-denominational interracial church. We have campuses here in Beaufort, in Graniteville, and in Grays, South Carolina. And if you don't have a place to go, we'd love to invite you. You can go to communitybiblechurch.us for details. And if you're not following me on YouTube, follow me on YouTube. Search the scriptures, Carl Brogy on YouTube. And that will help other people to find God's word and learn the truth of what God has revealed. God bless you as you walk with Christ today.